Hello all, welcome to my engineering physics channel. This is Sanjeev Bade from KJ Somaiah Institute of Engineering and Information Technology. This is our session 3 on crystallography, and in this session we are going to discuss X-ray diffraction, Bragg's X-ray spectrometer and how Bragg's X-ray spectrometer can be used for the determination of crystal structure. In the beginning, let us try to answer some of the questions. What is diffraction? What are X-rays? And why X-rays are used in the study of crystal physics? So let us try to answer these questions one by one. So first let us take what is diffraction. So let us try to answer the first question. What is diffraction? Diffraction is bending of light waves when the light waves are incident at an aperture. So this bending of light waves results in a diffraction pattern on the screen, which is kept in front of the slit or aperture. This diffraction pattern contains alternatively placed maxima and minima. The amount of bending depends on width of the slit. If width of the slit is large, then the amount of bending is less and small diffraction effect is observed. And if the width of the slit is very small, then amount of bending is more and the diffraction effect can be observed clearly. So, the width of the slit has something to do with the diffraction effect. If width of the slit is very large, the bending amount of bending is little and diffraction effect will not be seen clearly. If width of the slit is small, comparable to wavelength of light used in the experiment, then the amount of bending is more and diffraction effect can be seen clearly. So, for observing the diffraction effect clearly, the width of the slit should be comparable to the wavelength. So, if you are using a slit of a large width, then we will have to select the wave having the large wavelength. If you are using the slit of little width, then wavelength of the wave selected should be small one. So, for getting the diffraction pattern clearly, width of the slit should be comparable to the wavelength of the wave used in the experiment. Then only we are going to get the considerable diffraction effect. So just remember this point, wavelength of the wave used in the experiment must be comparable with the width of the slit used in the diffraction experiment. Then only we are going to get the considerable diffraction effect. So let us come to the next question. What are X-rays? X-rays are the electromagnetic waves having very short wavelength in the range of 1 to 10 angstroms. So these are the wavelengths in meter. X-rays fall somewhere over here. Gamma rays will have very small wavelength and radio waves will have very large wavelength. X-rays are the waves having the wavelength of the order of 1 to 10 angstroms here. Why X-rays are used in the study of crystal physics? We know in a crystal, atoms are arranged following certain geometrical pattern and atoms form a closely packed structure to get minimum energy. These atoms are assumed to be spherical in shape. So when these spheres are kept close to each other, then some void space remains between them. This void space can be utilized as a slit. So, we can have the atomic plane passing through the centers of these atoms and another atomic plane passing through the centers of these atoms, and these are the slits which will be placed very close to each other. So, this crystal structure can be utilized as a diffraction grating. Diffraction grating is an arrangement of number of slits which lie very close to each other. So, we will be having number of slits which will be lying very close to each other. So, in a diffraction experiment, this crystal is going to be used as a diffraction grating. Now, why X-rays are used in this diffraction experiment? If you find the width of the slit, which will be of the order of diameter of the atom, and diameter of the atom is of the order of few angstroms, 1 or 2 angstroms. So, in order to perform the diffraction experiment, we need waves having the wavelength of this order, that is of the order of 1 or 2 angstroms. So, as the separation between the atoms used as a slit is of the order of 1 or 2 angstroms, we will get observable pattern if we use wave having the wavelength of the same order, and wavelength of x-rays is of that order. Therefore, we use x-rays if we want to perform the diffraction experiment when crystal is used as a diffraction grating. But why are we performing the x-ray diffraction experiment? The results of this x-ray diffraction experiments can be analyzed to find out this d, width of this slit, that is the distance between the centers of these atoms, interplanar spacing. So this interplanar spacing can be found out by analyzing the diffraction pattern. So we can find out the interplanar spacing in different directions by changing the direction of the crystal which is being used as the diffraction grating. So we can find out this d, we can find out this d, we can find out this d, and by finding out the interplanar spacings in different directions, we can actually find out the crystal structure, the arrangement of atoms inside the crystal. So that is the purpose of doing X-ray diffraction experiments. And why are we using X-rays only? Because the width of the slit that is being used as a grating is comparable to wavelength of X-rays. So therefore, X-rays are selected for performing the diffraction experiment. For analyzing the diffraction pattern, that means to find out width of the slit involved in the diffraction experiment, we need a relation. So that relation was found out by W.L. Bragg and W.H. Bragg. So this relation is called as Bragg's law of X-ray diffraction. So let us try to get this Bragg's law of X-ray diffraction. To get this Bragg's law of X-ray diffraction, let us make monochromatic X-rays incident on the atomic planes inside the crystal. The angle at which these X-rays are incident on the plane is theta. This theta is called as the glancing angle. Ray 1 is reflected from point A on the plane number 1, and ray 2 is reflected from point B on plane number 2. This d is the interplanar distance. So this d is the width of the slit on the grating. Now you can see clearly from this diagram, ray number 2 is traveling longer distance as compared to the ray number 1. So the path difference between ray number 1 and ray number 2 will be CB plus BD. So up to point A and C, both rays are traveling same distance, and point A and point D onwards, again the rays are traveling same distance. The additional distance traveled by ray number 2 is CB plus BD. So this CB plus BD is called as the path difference. From this triangle ACB, we can write CB to be equal to D sin theta, and from this triangle ADB, we can write BD to be equal to D sin theta. If this angle is theta, this will be 90 minus theta, and as this is normal drawn to the atomic plane, if this is 90 minus theta, this has to be theta. Same logic we can apply here, and we can say that this angle is also theta, and therefore CB and BD can be written as D sin theta. So we can put these values of CB and BD in the path difference relation, and path difference between ray number 1 and ray number 2 can be written as CB plus BD, that is equal to D sin theta plus D sin theta, because CB and BD both are equal to D sin theta. So path difference is 2D sin theta. Now if path difference is 2D sin theta, then maximum in the diffraction pattern is obtained when this path difference is integral multiple of lambda, that is path difference is equal to n lambda, where n is equal to an integer 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on. So here path difference obtained is 2d sin theta, and therefore condition for maximum can be written as 2d sin theta equal to n lambda, and this condition for maximum is known as Bragg's law of X-ray diffraction. So Bragg's law of X-ray diffraction is nothing but the condition for maximum, that is 2d sin theta equal to n lambda. So using this condition for maximum, using this Bragg's law of X-ray diffraction, the width of the slit, that is the interplanar spacing, can be found out. This d can be calculated. If we measure the value of theta for a given value of lambda, we can calculate d if we know the order of the maximum n. So this Bragg's law of X-ray diffraction is very, very important in the analysis of the diffraction pattern. With the help of this, we can find out the interplanar spacing in different directions and we can identify the crystal structure followed inside the crystal. So now we have a relation which can be used for analyzing the crystal structure, 2d sin theta equal to n lambda, which is called as Bragg's law of X-ray diffraction. With the help of this relation, we can find out d if we know the angle theta for the maximum and order of the maximum and wavelength of X-rays used in the experiment. So if all these three things are known, then the interplanar spacing can be calculated. So in an experiment, X-ray diffraction experiment, we can select X-rays of a particular wavelength. So wavelength will be known to us. To find d, we need angle theta for a particular order of maximum. So to find angle theta for a particular angle of maximum, we need to perform the experiment with the help of one particular apparatus, which is called as Bragg's X-ray spectrometer. So this Bragg's X-ray spectrometer will be used to find out theta for a particular order of maximum. And once theta is known for a particular order of maximum, then d can be calculated. So this is a diagram showing construction of Bragg's X-ray spectrometer. In this apparatus, monochromatic X-rays are obtained from the X-ray tube. So this is the X-ray tube which will generate X-rays for us. When high-speed electrons strike the target having high atomic number, high melting point, X-rays are given out. So these X-rays are meant to pass through two slits, S1 and S2, in order to get a fine beam of X-rays. So purpose of this two slits is to get a narrow beam of X-rays. So this narrow beam of X-rays is made incident on a crystal which is being used as a reflection grating. So crystal is used as a reflection grating in this experiment. This crystal is mounted on a circular turntable. This table can be rotated, so the crystal will also get rotated along with it, and we can change the glancing angle. We can select the glancing angle as per our requirement. There is a rotating arm which can be kept at different angles and which is used to collect the X-rays. This rotating arm has got one ionization chamber which is filled with methyl bromide. When X-rays enter into this ionization chamber, they produce the ionization and the current in this circuit can be obtained. The magnitude of the current noted in this current meter depends on the intensity of X-rays entering in this ionization chamber. More is the intensity, more will be the current. The rotating arm can be kept at different angles and the intensity of X-rays can be noted in different directions by finding out the current in this current meter. The reading for angle theta can be noted in this window. So this is how the Bragg's X-ray spectrometer is set up. So by rotating this arm, we can find out intensity of X-rays at different angles. So intensity of X-rays is directly proportional to the ionization current measured in this galvanometer. After finding out the ionization current at different angles, we can plot the graph of current versus glancing angle, and this graph will show us the peaks where the maximas are obtained for a particular angle theta. This experiment can be performed again by rotating the crystal so that the planes having different orientation will get involved in the diffraction experiment. So for different planes, the theta for a particular order of maximum, for example first order of maximum, is found out, and we know from Bragg's law of diffraction this d is directly proportional to lambda upon sin theta. So if you find out theta 1, theta 2, theta 3 for a particular order of maximum for planes 100, 110, 111, we can write this ratio D100 is to D110 is to D111 to be equal to 1 by sin theta 1 is to 1 by sin theta 2 is to 1 by sin theta 3, where theta 1, theta 2, theta 3 are the angles at which a particular order of maximum is obtained for all these three planes. Once this ratio is obtained, we can compare this ratio with the known ratios for different crystal structures. For simple cubic structure, this ratio is 1 is to 1 by root 2 is to 1 by root 3. So, if the ratio obtained in the experiment matches with this, then we can comment that the given crystal follows a simple cubic structure. For body centered cubic, this ratio is 1 is to root 2 is to 1 by root 3. For face centered cubic structure, it is 1 is to 1 by root 2 is to 2 by root 3. So, if the ratio calculated in the experiment matches with any of these ratios, then we can comment that a particular crystal structure is followed inside the crystal. These ratios are obtained by studying the geometry of the particular crystal structure. So, this is how Bragg's X-ray spectrometer can be used to identify or determine the crystal structure followed inside the crystal by the atomic arrangement. So, with this example, it will be more clear how the crystal structure is found with the help of Bragg's results obtained in the Bragg's X-ray diffraction experiment. For NaCl, first order maxima for 100, 110 and 111 planes are obtained as 5.9 degrees, 8.4 degrees and 5.2 degrees respectively. Which crystal structure is followed by NaCl? So, we will just find out the ratio D100 is to D110 is to D111, that is 1 by sin theta 1 is to 1 by sin theta 2 is to 1 by sin theta 3. Theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, the angles for first order maximum for all these planes is given to us, and this ratio is obtained as 9.73 is to 6.84 is to 11.03. If you divide all these values by this value, that is 9.73, we get it as 1 is to 1 by root 2 is to 2 by root 3, and this is the ratio for FCC structure, and therefore we can conclude that the given crystal NaCl follows face centered cubic structure. So, this is how the crystal structure is found out with the help of Bragg's X-ray diffraction experiment. This is one more simple problem based on Bragg's law of X-ray diffraction. Bragg's reflection of the first order was observed at 21.7 degrees for parallel planes of a crystal under test. If the wavelength of X-rays used is 1.54 angstroms, find the interplanar spacing for the planes in the crystal. So, here D is asked, interplanar spacing, N is given, first order, so N is equal to 1, lambda is given 1.54 angstroms, that is 1.54 into 10 to the minus 10 meters, and theta, the angle at which the first order maximum is obtained, is given as 21.7. So, this is a simple substitution problem. We'll just write the relation for D as n lambda upon 2 sin theta, and we'll substitute the values, and D can be obtained after calculation as 2.083 angstroms. So, in this problem, the value of D is 2.083 angstroms. The spacing between principal planes in a crystal of NaCl is 2.82 angstroms. It is found that the first order Bragg's reflection occurs at 10 degrees. What is the wavelength of X-rays? At what angle second order reflection occurs? And what is the highest order of reflection that can be seen? So, here three questions are asked. First, we will collect the data from the problem. The interplanar spacing is given as 2.82 angstroms. So, that is 2.82 into 10 to minus 10 meters. Order of the maximum first order is given to us. So, n is equal to 1. And theta is given as 10 degrees. So, according to Bragg's law of X-ray diffraction, we can write 2d sin theta equal to n lambda. We are asked to find out wavelength of X-rays. So, let us write the relation for X-rays, wavelength of X-rays. So, that is 2d sin theta upon n. Just put the values given and we can get the value of lambda as 9.79 into 10 raised to minus 11 meters. That is 0.979 angstroms. So wavelength of x-rays we have found out. Second problem is at what angle the second order reflection occurs. So now we know the value of lambda. We can just put the value of n to be equal to 2 and we can get the value of theta. So d is known to us, lambda is known to us, n will be put as 2 and value of theta can be obtained. So theta can be written from this relation as sine inverse n lambda upon 2d. N is put as 2, lambda we just now calculated, d is given, and the theta can be calculated from this relation as 20.31 degrees. So second problem also we have solved. Third is, what is the highest order of reflection seen? So for highest order we will put the value of sine theta equal to 1. So we can write the relation for order of the maximum n to be equal to 2d sine theta upon lambda, and for maximum value of n, sine theta will be put to be equal to maximum, and maximum value of sine theta is equal to 1. D is constant, lambda is constant, so this we cannot change. So sine theta, when sine theta is maximum, n will be maximum. So by putting sine theta equal to 1, we can get n max to be equal to 5.76. But n is what? N is an integer. So n is less than 6 means n is not equal to 6, and the highest value less than 6 is 5. So as n is an integer, the highest order that can be seen in this case is 5. So 5 orders of maximum will be seen. Calculate the smallest glancing angle at which K copper line of 1.549 angstroms will be reflected from crystal having atomic spacing 4.255 angstroms. So let us collect the data from the problem. Wavelength is given as 1.549 angstroms. The atomic spacing, that is D, is given as 4.255 angstroms. The smallest glancing angle means n will be equal to 1. Smallest glancing angle means n will be equal to 1. See, 2d sin theta equal to n lambda. So theta will be minimum when n is equal to minimum, and minimum value of n is 1. So we want to find out this theta for n equal to 1. So just write the relation for theta as sin inverse n lambda upon 2d, and put the value of n equal to 1. D is given to us, lambda is also given to us. So put the values of D and lambda and calculate the value of theta. It can be obtained as 10.48 degrees. Calculate the glancing angle on the plane 100 of a rock salt A equal to 2.814 angstroms corresponding to second order diffraction maximum for x-rays of wavelength 0.714 angstroms. So here plane is given as 100, so HKL is 100. Lattice constant is 2.814 angstroms, and wavelength of x-rays used in the experiment is given as 0.714 angstroms. N is given as 2, second order means n is equal to 2, and we are asked to find out the theta glancing angle at which the second order maximum is obtained. Now this is the unit cell for rock salt, and this is plane 100 in the rock salt. So in a rock salt, the interplanar spacing for plane 100 is a by 2, we can see from this diagram, and therefore the interplanar spacing we will write as a by 2, which is 2.814 into 10 to minus 10 divided by 2, that is 1.407 into 10 to minus 10 meter. So in the Bragg's law of X-ray diffraction, 2d sin theta equal to n lambda, we will put this value of d to calculate the value of theta. So theta is sin inverse of n lambda upon 2d. N is given as 2, second order, lambda is given 0.714 angstroms, d we have calculated 1.407 into 10 to minus 10 meters. So we can calculate the value of theta by using these values, and the value of theta obtained is 30.5 degrees. X-rays of wavelength 1.5418 angstroms are diffracted by 111 planes in a crystal at an angle of 30 degrees in the first order. Calculate the lattice constant of the cubic unit cell. So here wavelength of X-rays is given as 1.5418 angstroms, that is 1.5418 into 10 to the minus 10 meters. Plane is given as 111, so HKL is equal to 111, H is equal to 1, K is equal to 1 and L is equal to 1. Theta is 30 degrees, order is 1, first order. We are asked to find out lattice constant. Now interplanar spacing is given by DHKL is equal to A by square root of H square plus K square plus L square. This relation we have already found for interplanar spacing and the lattice constant in cubic structure. So this is a cubic structure, so we can use this relation. According to Bragg's law of X-ray diffraction, 2d sin theta equal to n lambda. So first what we will do, we will calculate d using this Bragg's law of X-ray diffraction, and we will put this d here and we will calculate the lattice constant A. H, K, L are given to us. So to find d, we will write the relation for d as d equal to n lambda upon 2 sin theta. N is equal to 1, first order. Lambda is given to us 1.5418 angstroms, and theta is given to us 30 degrees. So d can be calculated as 1.5418 into 10 to the minus 10 meters. So actually here sin theta will be equal to 1 by 2. So 2, 2 will get cancelled and lambda will be equal to d. So once d is calculated, we can write the relation for a as d hkl into square root of h square plus k square plus l square. And we can calculate value of A. So A will be 1.5418 into square root of 1 square plus 1 square plus 1 square, that is square root of 3, and that value is obtained as 2.670 angstroms. So the here we used 1.5418 as in angstroms. So final answer for lattice constant will be in angstroms. So the lattice constant in this problem is 2.670 angstroms. So we are at the end of session number 3 on crystallography. This was our last session. In this session we have discussed how the Bragg's law of X-ray diffraction and Bragg's X-ray spectrometer can be used to find out the crystal structure followed inside the crystal by the atomic arrangement. So I hope you must have enjoyed this lecture. And if you like this lecture, then please subscribe to this channel so that you will get timely intimation of new videos uploaded to the channel. If you have any doubts, if you have any queries, you can contact me. So thank you once again. Thank you very much.